Hello out there in YouTube land, and welcome to the House of Jonfeld. Today's video is on my pal Catherine Dover, and I will be discussing several of her best films. As a youngster, this North Carolina native always aspired to work in the theater, and she and her siblings would often put on plays in which she would design and make the outfits her cast would wear. She even dressed up her cats and dogs. It was while attending Catawba College, majoring in theater, that she got her first job as an assistant art director on the film shooting in North Carolina, The Private Eyes. It was from the film's art director, Vincent Piranio, that she learned so much about film production. She crossed paths with Deborah L. Scott, the film's set costumer, and Scott brought Katie, as she was known to everyone, to Hollywood to assist her on a film she was designing. The film was E.T., the Extraterrestrial, and it set the ball rolling on Katie's career in costumes. Katie's first official solo credit as costume designer was the comedy cult classic Eating Raoul, the story of Paul and Mary Bland, played by Bartel and Mary Voronov, who kill swingers with a frying pan and steal their money in hopes of opening up their own restaurant, and Raoul, played by Robert Beltran, who is also in on the action with sinister plans of his own. Eating Raoul was a passion project of actor-director Paul Bartel, and since no studio wanted to back the film, Bartel had to raise the money through friends and family, shooting at a real apartment on weekends over the course of a year using short-in film stock. The film proved to be a challenging shoot, and keeping continuity was an uphill battle. Katie was frustrated by this, and one day Deborah Nadulman happened to be visiting the set and pulled Katie aside to give her some words of encouragement. Nadulman told Katie about the same trouble she had on previous films that Katie was experiencing and not to give up. Katie took her words to heart, and it meant so much coming from her that it stayed with her. For the wardrobe, Katie begged, borrowed, scrounged through all the secondhand shops in Los Angeles. She assembled a very colorful and hilarious wardrobe like Mr. Baker's tight blue violet polyester getup that was a staple of the 70s swinger scene. Mary in a white transparent dress that shows off her collateral. The imaginative hippie costumes worn by Mary and the hippie swinger. Mr. Cray's Hawaiian shirt and Paul's corduroy jacket and bow tie. Below is Katie's concept sketch for Mary, and it shows Katie's talent as an illustrator. I also want to show Robert Schulenberg's charming set of fabulous 50s furniture, and I almost forgot all about James from the Valley's yellow and lavender polyester jacket. This film was also Katie's on-screen debut, where she played the body of the drunk swinger in The Trash Bag. Since she was 5'2", Paul asked her to double for the actor since she was so tiny and could fit in The Trash Bag. Poor Katie had to wear the character's ugly polyester pants and shoes. Eating Raoul was released on March 24, 1982 to critical acclaim and highlighted Katie's flair for comedy, and she showed that flair in other comedies like They Call Me Bruce and Muggsy's Girls. In 1985, Katie designed costumes for Andrei Konchalovsky's Runaway Train, starring John Voight and Eric Roberts as Manny and Buck. Two escaped convicts find themselves trapped on a train with no brakes and nobody driving. Believe it or not, this film was by the Cannon Group, and it was one of their rare good films. Here is Manny wearing a red tee with an American eagle on front and a Blatnik cap. This was Manny in prison, and a bodysuit was sculpted for his chest and arms as his character spent a lot of his days working out, and they wanted to show that he had upper body strength. John was very muscular and tall, but thin. That gave him the extra push to say he spent a lot of time in prison. Manny and Buck outside the train yard as they had successfully escaped prison and found these items of clothing in the locker room of the train yard. Katie dressed them in as many layers as possible to combat the cold and was able to have these layers modified when they were shooting on a soundstage in Los Angeles. They still looked as if they were wearing all those layers and trying to keep warm. Eric Roberts hanging off the side of the train, and this sequence was shot in the famous Pan Pacific building and had three trains set up on stage there. Manny in an orange hoodie, and this scene was shot in sequence in Alaska where it snowed 6 feet some days. The hoodie and vest were aged and dirty, but the orange color was a reminder of where the character had been. Runaway Train was released to good reviews, and come award season it received 3 Oscar nominations for its editing and for John Voight as Best Actor and Eric Roberts for Best Supporting Actor. Voight also won a Golden Globe for Best Actor in a Drama. 1987 saw another release by the Cannon Group that opened to acclaim called Shy People. Andrei Konchalovsky was director, and he brought Katie back to design the costumes. The story is about Diana Sullivan, played by Jill Clayburgh. A New York journalist visits her distant cousin Ruth, played by Barbara Hershey, for the first time to write an article about her hard life in the bayous of Louisiana. Diana's wild, drug-addicted daughter Grace, played by Martha Plimpton, just adds to the tensions between the two families' cultures. Katie designed Diana's dress and was constructed by a tailor in Louisiana, and a total of 10 were made for the production, as were many multiples were needed. It was the 1980s and big shoulders were in fashion, but Katie didn't want Diana to look athletic, so smaller pads were used, and Katie then added a belt, jewelry, and a lovely summer hat. Barbara's costume was a period house dress from the 1940s. The director and Katie talked through the idea that Barbara's character was the second wife of the old man she married, and these dresses had belonged to the first wife. They added some contemporary pieces with her clothes, like a blue chambray work shirt was probably purchased at a farm store. She wore a lot of practical clothes, aprons, and rubber gum boots. Ruth again wore a 1940s house dress with a wool sweater underneath and white gum boots for practicality. Diana wore this yellow dress that was also manufactured by the production's tailor in Louisiana. The dress also needed to have multiples because her character ended up in the swamp. Mayor Winningham, who played Candy, the daughter-in-law, was actually pregnant, so Katie accentuated her pregnancy from the beginning in order to allow her natural pregnancy to grow without having to show off a pregnancy pad in the very hot weather of the bayou. Martha Plimpton wore a New York digitized sweater and leggings. Shy People premiered at the Cannes Film Festival on May 14, 1987, and Barbara Hershey won the Best Actress Prize for her portrayal of Ruth. Once upon a time, in Austin, Texas, a little film was produced called Dazed and Confused. It was a period picture set in 1976 on the last day of school before summer vacation. The film was written and directed by Richard Linklater, and he based it on his high school years in Huntsville High School. Katie was recruited to put together a 70s wardrobe by Linklater, and he said he wanted everything to look authentic. All of the items were actual vintage 70s clothes rented from several costume houses in LA. Denim bell bottoms, embroidered peasant blouses, wide collar shirts, large belts, and an assortment of shoes from boots to platforms. The item of clothing that stood out to me was the green printed polyester shirt worn by Mitch, played by Wiley Wiggins. a freshman who is mercilessly hazed, and out of remorse, Pink, played by Jason London, takes him cruising with his friends. The film was a remarkable achievement for a period film made on a low budget, $6 million to be exact, and a big chunk of that was spent on the soundtrack. When released on September 24, 1993, the movie became a sleeper hit with audiences and the reviews were good. The movie was Katie's finest hour, and in my opinion, she should have been nominated for an Academy Award for her stellar work. When you watch the film now, it reads like a who's who in Hollywood, for at the time the cast was unknown, and the standout being Matthew McConaughey as Wooderson and his improvised line, "All right, all right, all right." A star was born. It's very interesting to note that movies set in the 1970s before Dazed and Confused stripped away all the 70s period detail, and the 80s influence was there. After Dazed and Confused, movies set in the 70s went all out to look 70s in films like The Ice Storm, Boogie Nights, Almost Famous, Munich, and American Hustle. The books of Danielle Steele were very popular in the 80s and 90s, and NBC adapted many of them for television. Remembrance was the story of a young woman named Serena, played by Eva LaRue, and a soldier named Brad Fullerton, played by Jeffrey Nordling. They fall in love and marry during World War II. This was Katie's most glamorous project after years of doing films with gritty and biting characters. Angie Dickinson played Margaret Fullerton, the disapproving mother-in-law, and her costumes were custom-made from Katie's designs at Muto Little Costume House in Los Angeles. Angie loved the costumes so much she wanted to keep them, and NBC granted her wishes. Eva LaRue wore a red dress that was also a Dover original made at Muto Little. The period military uniforms were all provided from the United America costumes and provided by her friends Lester Bayless and his daughter Diana. The producer had a strange request about the costumes. To quote him, "The film is 1940, World War II, but we don't want it to be period." Confused by that statement, Katie tried to get clarification, and they wanted to leave off all the men and women wearing hats and gloves. She managed to persuade them to reconsider this request, and in the end, Katie was right. Her next project was Get to the Heart, the Barbara Mandrell story, a TV adaptation of country legend Barbara Mandrell's book of the same name. Maureen McCormick played the role of Ms. Mandrell, and once again, Katie was like a kid in a candy store getting to design an array of gowns and dresses in the candy colors of the 1960s. Both Remembrance and Get to the Heart were two good showcases of Katie's work, showing her whimsicality and her playful use of color. Both films were worthy of any consideration, but unfortunately they were overlooked. Costume design is not Katie's only talent. She is also a very much in-demand costume supervisor. A costume supervisor works closely with the designer. In addition to helping with the design of the costumes, they manage the wardrobe workspace, they supervise construction or sourcing of garments, hiring and firing of support staff, budget, paperwork, and department logistics. Thanks to her razor-sharp abilities as a supervisor, she saved many productions from a costume budget landslide. After 113 film and TV credits, Katie decided to retire to Tocca da Casoria, Italy, far away from the hustle and bustle of Hollywood. She fell in love with the beauty of the Italian countryside and has made it her home. After a 40-year career in films and television, I believe it is time for Katie to be honored by the Costume Designers Guild for her career achievement. And an award for this lady's work has been constantly good, and she is a role model of professionalism that has kept her steadily employed over the course of her career. It is sad that there will no longer be any more Catherine Dover films or TV shows. And as the saying goes, all good things must come to an end. But at least we have an abundance of her work to enjoy. Hope you enjoyed the video. Like and subscribe, and that's the way the cow ate the cabbage.